Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
And I'm Laura Drake. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or right here on TV.
And here's how the show works. There's teachers from Dowell, teachers standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
Now, if you'd like help with your homework, call Dial a Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
All right, or you can also send us your questions here at our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Yak Back button and send in your questions. Okay, it's Tuesday, and that means it's time for our creature teaser.
Yay! Okay, this is a great one. This creature is said to be a feathered giant because of its large wingspan, which can reach up to 11 feet. There are 24 different types of this species, and they all use their large wingspan to float on the ocean winds and glide for hours without rest.
Now, this creature sometimes floats on the ocean surface, but in doing so, it makes it easy prey for other water animals. Now, this creature is rarely seen on land and can live up to 50 years.
Wow, if you think you can solve this creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share your answer at the end of this very show.
But every correct response made at our Hotline Hall of Fame, and if you earn enough points, you go in a tablet at the end of the season. All right, and you have a question for us.
I do.
We lost the call?
We lost the call. So we had Rosemary, who called from New Jersey with a great seventh grade percent problem. And I'm going to do it, even though we can't find Rosemary back on the phone. We lost her. So I'm going to go over to the board. All right. So, Rosemary, hopefully you're paying attention and you hung in there with us. Okay. So Rosemary's problem is somebody brought a video game system and it cost $99.50. Okay. So it cost $99.50. Well, Rosemary's a savvy shopper, and she's not going to buy it for $99.50. It is on sale, maybe because it's post-holidays, at 35% off. And the question that Rosemary was asked is, so how much is she going to pay for this video game system, okay? So there's a whole bunch of ways to solve this. Today, I'm in the mood to do a tape diagram. Since I don't have Rosemary to talk to me, I'm gonna go with the tape diagram. It's a nice visual model. It's a little less stressful. Sometimes it takes a little bit longer, but it really shows me that I understand what's going on in the math. So I'm gonna go with the tape diagram. So a couple things I gotta keep in mind while I'm doing this. I'm gonna draw a big piece of tape. And this piece of tape stands for the entire price for the video game system. And I know the entire price for the video game system is $99.50. And that stands for the entire price. And I know that I'm gonna take 35% off, so I need to start thinking about percents. And one of the beauties of using percents is there's some benchmark numbers and things that I can use in there. And I know that in percents, I could break it into 10%, because an entire thing is 100%. So I'm gonna take this bar, this piece of tape, and I'm gonna break it into 10 pieces. I'm gonna try to make them about the same, but I'm not gonna stress about it. I'm gonna try and get 10 pieces on here. And each part, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So I have 10 different sections in here. I drew 9 bars, which breaks into 10 sections. Each of these pieces is 10% of the price, okay? So when I broke it up, this piece is 10%, this piece is 10%, and I just know that each of these is 10%. So you're like, okay, what does that have to do with this problem? This problem is telling me that it's 35% off. Well, I'm gonna use 2 different pieces of math going on here to think about this. So a lot of kids make the problem harder by trying to figure out how much you're taking off of the price. And that's an okay strategy, but that's not what the question is asking. The question is asking you, how much is the price gonna be when it's left. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a little bit of the subtracting in the beginning to make it a little bit easier for myself. So I know that if it's 100% to begin with, and if I'm going to take off 35%, I know what I'm paying for is 65%. And so you might see people who are really good at math and they're able to do percents really quickly in their head, like they're in the store and they're like, oh, it's 30% off, it's gonna cost this amount of money. What they're doing in their head is, first of all, they're thinking about what they're paying for right away. So don't think about what you're saving, think about what you're actually paying for, okay? Because that's what's gotta come out of your pocket. So my goal here is I wanna figure out what's 65% of this. When I find out what's 65% of $99.50, that I'm gonna have the final price for the video game system. So now each of these is 10%, and that makes it really easy. When I find 10% of the number, and I know Rosemary's in seventh grade, 10% of the number is really just a matter of moving the decimal over. So I know that each of these pieces, let's flip our color here, is gonna be worth $9.95. So all I really did was I moved the decimal over on $99.50, one space, okay? So we divided it by 10. So it's 10% is you're gonna divide it by 10. Think about it, we divided each of these pieces into 10 pieces. So each piece is $9.95, okay? And I could write $9.95 in each of those, and I'm kind of feeling like I wanna do it for some of those right now, even though it's not very exciting. So here they all are in there. Okay, so each of these pieces is $9.95. That's great. We're getting a little bit closer. So now when I think about how much she has to pay for the thing, she's gonna pay for 65%. So let me switch my color. This would be 10%. This would be another 20%, 30%, 40%, 50%, 60%. Right here is 60%. And I know I'm gonna need another half of a 9.95, okay? And so I know I'm gonna need half of this one. So quickly in my head, I'm gonna figure out what's half of 9.95. And we could do a quick two goes into 9.995. And I know it seems like it's a lot of work, but it really shows me that you're understanding that 65% is made up of a whole bunch of different pieces of percents, chunking it up. So two goes into nine four times, and we have an eight. We subtract it, we bring down the nine, two goes into 19 nine times, we have an eight. Two goes into 15 seven times. We have a 14. We have one left over. So two goes into 10. So it's 4.975. We're going to round this for 4.98. So this little teeny tiny piece here is 4.98, this extra piece that we have to put. So wait, 6, and then another half is 4.97. So all I really got to do to figure this out is I have 9.95. And I have six pieces at 9.95, and I'm gonna multiply that out. And by the time you get into seventh grade, and especially if you have a calculator, which you will have, this is a breeze when you've got a calculator. 5 times 6 is 30, 5 times that's, we're gonna carry the 7, carry the 5, 9 times 6 is 54, 59, 70. And then we still have to add the 4.97 for the end. And when we add all those up, and again, so much better if you've got a calculator, the final price after I've added up all the pieces of the percents is $64.67. So don't be afraid of the tape diagrams. They just really show that you have an understanding of what's going on. You're doing the same thing in the math when you use an equation or whatever, but this just really shows that you understand all the pieces that make up the whole. Thanks, Rosemary, for that great question. I was excited to do it. I said,
hey, hey. Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
Okay, before we go to our next question, if you caught in that last one, Laura said she was rounding it to 98, but then she wrote 97, so the final answer would have been 64.98. So she said the right thing, but then she wrote the wrong thing. And you know what? We all do that, so that's why we should always go back and check our answers. So I'm going to go to the board now. I've got a review question that's off the 8th grade exam. This is the 8th grade science test. And I thought it was interesting because just before I came over here, I was talking to a young man who was in high school, but we were talking about the periodic table, and then I saw this question was on the periodic table. I thought it'd be a good one to do tonight. So it says, base your answers to question 30 to 32 on this portion of the periodic table, the elements below, and on your knowledge of science. So this is just showing us a portion of the periodic table. So I thought it'd be interesting to look at. Here's the whole table together, and actually a better one to look at this point would be this one. And the portion we're going to be seeing is over in this end. Now, the periodic table is arranged by atomic number. Okay, for those taking chemistry and those in science and in 7th and 8th grade, the atomic number is the number of protons, and that determines what something is. The number of protons determines what an element is. Now, the other number that's prominent on here is atomic mass, and that's the total number of protons and neutrons. And the person actually asked me, you know, when did the periodic table originate? The first person to actually set up a periodic table was a Russian scientist named Mendeleev, but he set his periodic table up using atomic masses instead of the atomic numbers. Now, he actually left blanks for elements, he said, we later discover, and he set this table that was very correct, but not quite, because he used the atomic masses instead of atomic number. But, you know, kind of interesting story, one of the elements that he said would be found is this element right here, it's number 32, and actually the Germans found this, and they, at the time, were going to give credit to some Russian scientists who predicted it would be there, and still naming it after Mendeleev, they called it germanium. So Mendeleev eventually got something named after him later on down here after he got one of the post-uranium elements named after him. But Mendeleev predicted that we'd find this element and predicted its properties, but the Germans found it named after germanium instead of this Russian scientist at the time. So it's kind of cool to look at those little connections. But the questions that we're looking at have only a portion of this table. Now remember I said that it's arranged by atomic number, and if we look on here, that's the number at the top of these. So the portion we've got here is we've got helium up here, excuse me, left out hydrogen, and then we left out the first four elements in the second period, and then we start with boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen. So what we have here is the periods are the rows, and then these columns are sometimes called families, and the reason that it's arranged this way is the things in the columns would have similar chemical properties because they would have the same number of valence or electrons in their outer shell, and those are the ones that are involved in bonding that cause the chemical properties. With that in mind, let's look at some of the questions they asked us. First one said, for the information for the element lead is shown below. Okay, here's lead, it's number 82, okay? And they're asking which labeled space on the graph or this table here should be placed. Now remember, said these were arranged in order of increasing atomic number. So if we look down here on this bottom row, we got radon. Okay, we notice we've got these things that are labeled 86, 85, and then we've got a blanks. If this was 82, where would it go? So we've got 85, 84, 83, 82, and lead, notice it would be right down here in this column, it should be labeled C. Now you won't have the advantage of having this on the test, but we can look here and see, matter of fact, that's where is lead, it's in the same column as carbon. All right, so that was the first question. Let's look at the next one that was given to us. All right, it said, which element from this portion of the table chemically reacts in a way similar to the way that the element chlorine reacts. So if we look up here, chlorine is in this group right here. These are called the halogens. Now these are very active nonmetals. All of these are short one electron to filling their outer shell. And so remember I said the things in the similar column, those are the ones that would act similar to it. So we've got fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. If we look at our choices here, the one that would be similar would be iodine. It's in the same column or the same family. And the last question we got is, so which element is classified as a noble gas? All right, noble gas is actually kind of an old word for it. Or there's also, they used to be called the inert gases, although they're not completely inert. But this whole last column here are things that tend not to react with other things. Remember I said that last shell of electrons, that valence shell, is the one that determines how things react. And all the things in this column here have a filled outer shell, so they don't tend to react with anything. So it starts up with helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, down to radon. Radon's the one you may have heard, that's the one that sometimes people have to have their houses tested for. It's actually a radioactive gas. It's prevalent in this part of New York State, different parts of the states it's more prevalent than the other. But they test your house to make sure that you don't have that radon gas. If you do, there's things they can do to get the radon gas out of your homes. So that's required when homes are sold. But if we look at which one would also be in that column, we see the argon here is the one that also is a noble gas, or the one in the last column. So the big thing about the periodic table, when we look at the periodic table, is notice how things are arranged. Why are they arranged that way? Well, they're arranged in order of increasing atomic number, because it's the number of protons that determines what the element is, but the columns have similar properties.
said, hey, hey.
The order to solve a long division problem is divide, multiply, subtract, bring down. You can remember this order with a family: dad, mom, sister, brother.
All right, we'll get back to the questions in just a minute, but now we'd like to welcome our guests from the Seneca Park Zoo. We have Tim and Ice. Now, is Ice a stage name? Or
is this is his actual name, yeah. So Ice is an African four-toed hedgehog. And, of course, one of the predominant features you're going to see on him is those spines that are on his back. The spines are there as a defense mechanism for him. The spines are there to help make sure that nobody wants to eat him, of course, because, well, not very many things want to eat something that's got lots of spines and prickles and everything on it.
Yeah.
What's really neat about him is that he has a muscle that runs along his stomach that when he contracts it, it rolls him up into a ball and actually makes him go into a kind of a little pouch. Now, he doesn't like to do that, but when he does that and tightens up that muscle, it basically locks him into place so that nobody can really open him up to get at that soft little underbelly that he has.
Now, they sleep that way too, right?
That's right. He does sleep that way. So, and when he does roll up into that ball, all those spines go in lots of different directions, and making it very hard for anybody to pick him up without having some of those spines go into their mouth or their paw.
Oh. And, you know, it's interesting you should point out that these aren't related closely to porcupines or echidnas.
That's right.
You know, this is a defense that's evolved three separate times.
That's right, yeah. So they're not related. One of the things that does come up fairly often is when people are talking about those spines, one of the big differences between a spine on our hedgehog and the quill that's on a porcupine is that the two things is that the porcupine quill is made to fall out. So if you touch a porcupine quill, it's made to fall out because of the second thing, and that is there's barbs at the end of a porcupine quill, so that you basically get a lasting reminder in your hand or whatever to, that not to touch a porcupine. Mm-hmm. But as you guys noticed already, you can touch the spines on his back and be okay, as long as you don't just kind of jab your finger right into one of those.
Lost a few there.
That's right.
Similar to, you know, the needles fall off your Christmas tree.
That's right. Yeah.
And the bottom of a feather kind of.
Yeah. And they're modified hair so that they will grow back. He'll get them continuously throughout his life.
Yeah.
So that's like hair that's twisted together, kind of.
Basically. And there's a little hollow area inside of it as well. He's being a little shy right now.
Yeah, so. I see that. Well, you're talking earlier too where the name hedgehog came from. He was making noises earlier for us.
So he gets the name hedgehog because especially the European versions would be found in the hedgerows. Mm-hmm. And if you look at his nose, he's got kind of a hog or a pig-like nose.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one of the noises that you might have heard earlier is that he kind of huffs when he gets a little agitated. He'll huff himself a little bit, and that's just another little warning. Hey, look at me. Look at all those spines around me. You probably don't want to come near me.
Mm-hmm.
So he's got that snout. So does that tell me that the kind of food he eats, he digs for his food?
He has a great sense of smell. Okay. So basically that elongated snout is packed full of all of the sensory organs for receptors for him to be able to smell what's going on around him. He also has a really good sense of hearing, if you can see those really big ears of his.
And you'll be probably interesting, as long as you're talking about sensory, they tend to not have very good eyesight. But if we notice Ice here has red eyes, he's
an albino. That's right.
So they don't all look white.
That's right. Normally they're kind of a brown to a gray kind of color. He has albinism, which is a recessive trait genetically, and so he would has this bright white color and those red eyes. Now he is about 4 years old, but if he was out in the wild, he would probably not have survived this long because the coloration that would typically be found on a hedgehog would give him pretty good camouflage, but this would stand out really well. I mean, he lives in the African savanna and the grassland, so it would be very easy to find him out scurrying about even though he is nocturnal, it would only be out during the nighttime.
All right. Now, these were in the old category, insectivores, but they're more of an omnivore, right?
Yeah. He does like to eat a lot of insects, a lot of bugs, things like that. But he will also eat pretty much anything else he can get his mouth onto. He's been known to eat small mammals, bird eggs. They will eat little bits of vegetation here and there as well. So,
does he bite?
Well, anything with a mouth can bite.
Is he a good pet?
The question about is he a good pet, I always say is do your research first. He is a nocturnal animal, so he's typically going to be awake during the nighttime. Mm-hmm. He is not exactly a cute, cuddly animal, mm-hmm. but if you don't mind an animal that sleeps during the daytime, is awake during the nighttime, and you can't necessarily pick up and handle all the time, then it might not be a bad pet for you. Okay. But I would say do your research first.
Great. Thanks for bringing
them. Well, thanks, Tim. Thanks for bringing them on.
Nice to meet you, Ice. Wow. Do you want to know more about that animal and others like it? Go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on videos. He's so freaking cute.
Never say that about me.
Oh, sorry.
That's all right. You have a question for us.
I do. I'm going to go to the board, and I'm going to do a ninth grade math question. So this question is a ninth grade algebra question, and the question says, if A equals 3x squared plus 5x minus 6, and B equals negative 2x squared minus 6x plus 7, then A minus B. So we're trying to figure out when it says what's A minus B, they're just telling us they kind of got maybe a little lazy. They want you to set up the equation, then they want you to simplify it. So what we're going to do is we're going to do 3x squared plus 5x minus 6, and we're going to take away 2x squared plus, minus 6x plus 7. Okay, now what I wrote is not correct, okay? So when we look up here, it says A minus B, and you're like, Laura, it says A minus B, why isn't that correct? Well, we need to think about the fact that we're taking away the entire B, not just the first part of B, we have to take away the whole thing. So it's really important that you put this whole piece in parentheses. So you know it's the whole first one, and if you want to put the first one in parentheses, that's fine, and from that you're taking away the second one. So now when you're subtracting, monomials from each other, we're going to line up the ones that are alike. So if you notice, I put the x squares over the x squares, the x's over the x's, and the constants over the constants. So what we want to do is when you take away something, you're actually adding the opposite of it. So that subtraction sign says just to make everything inside the opposite of what it was. So I'm going to now go inside and I'm going to change everything to the opposite. So this was a positive 2x squared. So now it's a negative 2x squared. And this was a negative 6x, and now it's a positive 6x. And this was a positive 7, and now it's a minus 7, okay? So now I get to add the opposites. So I change everything to their opposites. So now it's a really easy problem. It's just about combining like terms. So when I look at this problem, I'm going to start with the x squares columns first. X squares can only combine with other x squares. So I have 3x squares, and from the 3x squares, you're going to take away 2x squares. So 3x squared, take away 2x squared, 3 take away 2 is 1. And now a lot of kids might get confused on x squared minus x squared, and you might think that you have to take the 2 away from the 2, and you don't. That's kind of just like its family name, so you just bring that name along with it, so it's 1x squared. On the next one, we have 5x, and we're going to add 6x to it. So we're going to do the same thing there. We're going to add the 5 plus the 6, and 5 plus 6 is 11, and we just keep the x the same. Okay? And then when we go to the negative 6 and we take away 7, well, a negative 6 and a negative 7 is negative 13. And now when I look at the original problem here, I see that I made a little mistake. Well, I'm not on my game today, so I'm glad that I'm paying attention and double-checking my work. I see that this started out with a negative 2x squared. So this should have been a negative 2x squared to begin with. Oh, my goodness. Okay? So now we got to go back. You had to do the opposite of negative 2x, negative 2x squared. So now we need to make it a positive 2x squared. So that would be the opposite of negative 2x squared. So instead of doing 3 take away 2, I had to add 3 plus 2x, which makes it a 5, makes it a 5x squared. So when we look at this problem in the end, the steps were that we changed the signs of everything on the bottom after we carefully copied them down, and then we combined the coefficients and then kept the terms the same.
All right, we've got a winner in tonight's Creature Teaser. Jackson, are you there?
Yes.
Hi, Jackson, how are you today?
Good.
Good. Now, Jackson, tell us what grade you're in.
Eighth grade.
Eighth grade, Jackson. And where do you go to school?
MSAP 588.
Okay, so you're in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
Jackson, what is our answer?
The albatross.
The albatross, right.
All right.
Oh, the albatross.
Albatross. How did you know that? Did you look it up, or did you know about the albatrosses?
I looked it up.
You looked it up? Well, you did a good job. All right. Well, great job. Now, congratulations, though, Jackson. Don't forget, every correct response goes in our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. And if you earn enough points, you go in a tablet at the end of the season.
So that's all the time we have for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dial-A Teacher's available with free homework help on the phone until 7 o'clock tonight.
And tomorrow on Homework Hotline, we'll continue our series called Move to Include. So we got some help waving here. You can wave. Goodbye now.
Night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.